When computing Fourier integrals, you often need to compute integrals of the form f of z times e to the power I omega z, where omega is some real number. We can use contour integration in those cases, but we have to be careful. If we want to close the contour in the upper half plane, we need to have omega positive. If omega is negative, you have to close in the lower half plane. Why is that? For positive omega, we have that I times omega times I times the imaginary part of z is negative in the upper half plane, which means that the function decays exponentially. But even for positive omega, we can encounter problems if f does not decay to zero fast enough, slower than 1 over r, because in those cases an MLL estimate will not work. And those cases arise quite a lot in practical examples. Fortunately, we have Jordan's lemma for those cases, which tells us that it's already enough if f goes to zero, so that's more powerful than an MLL estimate. Let us look at this powerful lemma in this video. So what are the conditions? Well, the function f of z has to be analytic in the upper half plane, so for I bigger equal than zero, and around some circle with radius r0, so you can take your r0 large. But outside that circle, your f has to be analytic. Furthermore, you will need a semicircle with a big radius capital R, CR, in the upper half plane. Your r has to be bigger than r0. Well, that's fine, you will want to take your r to infinity anyway. And on this circle CR, you want to have an MR, such that your f is bounded by this MR at norm on CR. And furthermore, you need your MR to vanish. Well, if your function doesn't even vanish, it will become pretty difficult to show that your integral converges. But now vanishing is already enough. Notice that it is a bit weaker than an ML estimate. Because the lemma says that for a bigger than zero, your integral will be equal to zero. And that's due to this additional factor e to the power I a z. If you wouldn't have that, then it wouldn't be valid. Because even if your function decays to zero, still, the path blows up as pi times r. So even if your function goes to zero, like say 1 over the square root of r, then the combination in integral would be 1 over the square root of r times pi r would still blow up. But this additional factor e to the power I a z will save it. And that is why just this limit going to zero will be enough for us. So why is this true? Well, let's set the stage. What is meant here? You'll have to be able to pick an R0 such that all the poles are safely away inside here. So F analytic here. So capital R outside, big R. And then you will have to show that F smaller equal than some MR here, where MR goes to zero. So that's the stage. Now, first we will use a little lemma in order to show this. A lemma for a real integral. Integral from 0 to power of 2 e to the power minus alpha sine theta d theta. Well, we cannot find an antiderivative, but we can estimate this using the inequality we did in the video before. We can show that this integral is smaller than pi over 2 alpha, or alpha bigger than 0. Now why is that? Well, that's because sine of theta is bigger or equal than 2 times theta over pi, as we showed in the previous video. So multiply with minus alpha, so minus alpha sine theta is smaller or equal than minus 2 alpha theta over pi. Putting it in the exponent, there's a change in equality. Exponential function is a monotonously increasing function. So e to the power minus alpha sine theta, smaller equal than e to the power minus 2 alpha theta over pi. Well, we cannot compute the antiderivative of this function over here, but we can compute the antiderivative of this function over here. So the integral of this function, which you cannot do, smaller equal than integral of a function which we candle. So what do we get? We compute this integral. It's just an exponential function. So e to the power a number times x, and the derivative equals 1 over number times e to the power a number times x. So that we get over what we get over there. Plug in the boundary values. Upper boundary value gives you this pi over 2 alpha times lower boundary times a minus 1, so over here, and upper boundary over here. So we get pi over 2 alpha times 1 minus positive number, which is smaller than pi over 2 alpha. And then you have the lemma over here, that your unknown integral, you can't compute explicitly, but you know that it is smaller than pi over 2 alpha. And you use the symmetry because you have a sine in your function. The sine from 0 to pi over 2 in the integral will give the same as the sine from pi over 2 to pi due to the symmetry of the sine. So the integral from 0 to pi will be twice as large, which means that your integral is below pi over alpha. Wow, this is quite a technical lemma, but now we have the lemma. We can derive Jordan's lemma straight away by just plugging the parameterization. The norm of your integral along CR of f, plug in z equals I times e to the power I theta. It's the norm. So you integrate from 0 to pi over t theta. The dz yields IR e to the power I theta d theta. You plug in z equals r e to the power I theta in your z. And you write z equals r times e to the power I theta equals r times cos theta plus I sine theta in your exponent. Let's clean up some of the mess. That's smaller equal than the line. We have to estimate something from that one. You can take the inequality inside, because the norm of an integral is smaller equal than the integral of the norm. And then we have that the norm of e to the power I a times r cosine theta, which is 1. So we have are left with e to the power minus a r sine theta. The norm of I equals 1, the norm of e to the power I theta equals 1, the norm of r equals r, so that can be taken outside over there. So we have cleaned up a lot of the mess now, and we're left with a real integral. We know by assumption that f is bound by some mr, so you get your r times mr times this integral over here. And now this additional factor is going to save us, because if mr would just go to 0, this r times mr could still blow up. But this additional factor will help us to show that this integral goes to 0 if f goes to infinity. Because we have this inequality over here, and using alpha equals ar, you get the r times mr times pi over ar. And now we see that this additional factor of r cancel out. So we get mr, missed the factor of pi over a. Well, that doesn't matter, because if you take r to infinity, your mr vanishes, which means that in the limit, the norm of the integral vanishes, and that's why the integral vanishes. So that's how Jordan's lemma works. That is why Jordan's lemma works. Well, as an engineer, you do not really have to be able to reproduce the whole proof. You have to be able to follow it, and you have to know how to apply Jordan's lemma. You have to know what the conditions are, and what the consequences, and when to apply Jordan's lemma in your own computations.